whatever it is.
So we will call this meeting to order. So if there's anybody that wants copies of the presentations, they're just on the podium there. First, we're going to have the manager presentation, and then we'll have the facilities manager provide some updates with regards to recreation programming.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. So the purpose of this meeting is really to twofold, is to provide a little bit of education as to where things sit with cannabis legislation as it is now, and to seek comments from anyone in the public who wishes to provide them, whether they be through the online survey that we have on our website or directly to members of council and staff. So back in December of 2018, council passed a decision to basically opt out of the cannabis retail stores until they had more information from the public, including engaged public, after which time they would come back and make an informed decision. It was felt that it was better to use that approach than to try and just opt in and then let the consequences be what they are. So here we are today. We had one meeting already at the beginning of March, and this is the second meeting. So as far as the Cannabis Act, it was passed in 2017 and prohibits the sale of recreational cannabis to anyone under the age of 19. It prohibits the use of recreational cannabis in all public spaces, workplaces, and motor vehicles. It prohibits youth under 19 from possessing, cultivating, consuming, or sharing any amount of it. It addresses illegal selling and includes storefront dispensaries. The Ontario or other provincial cannabis legislation includes the Smoke-Free Ontario Act, which regulates the smoking and vaping of medical cannabis. Amendments to the Highway Traffic Act were also establishing tougher impaired driving laws, including zero tolerance for young novice drivers. There is a link to the website there for individuals who want more information on other policy framework from the province there. So you can access this on the township website and get that link. Municipal and public health issues with cannabis. So generally, there's a risk of the risks of cannabis are not entirely clear, but we know that cannabis is not a benign substance and that it does have an impact on humans and behavior. So youth, the brain is not fully developed until the age of 25. So those individuals who can legally obtain it from, 20 years and on to 25, could potentially be doing further harm to themselves than would otherwise. Negative impacts for pregnant and breastfeeding mothers are not fully known. Drug-impaired driving impairment can last for longer than 6 hours. I've heard as much as it can be in your system for nearly a month. So where is the limit in terms of where you can and cannot consume it in terms of time frames?
Hardly any room.
The method of consumption, smoking harms your lungs, secondhand smoke, and the delayed effect with edibles is another key consideration for health impacts for cannabis. Municipal and public health issues. There's additional policing costs that will be associated with everything from potential drug overdoses to other behaviors associated with impairments. Additional demands on the healthcare system would also follow then with drug overdoses, etc. Municipal considerations for retail cannabis. So The site and licensing. Currently, there's a setback by the province of 150 meters setback from a school property. It's required to be sited in an existing commercial zone, and there are no limits on the retail store density, meaning you can have 10 of them in a square kilometer, and you cannot regulate the density as to how many stores you can have. And retail stores are to be exempted from municipal business licensing and land use planning bylaws, meaning we cannot pass land use planning bylaws that prohibit them, and we cannot regulate them in that way. If it says that a retail use is permitted, then it is allowed. And it will be up to the province then, through their licensing process, which I provided a link to the Alcohol and Gaming Commission website, which is the authority responsible for licensing them. That site actually provides a great deal of information on the licensing process, on how they do that, and what steps they have to take in order to get that, and your commenting ability on those licenses. But as far as land use planning, we do not have the ability to regulate it in that sense. As the So licensing of retail cannabis stores. As the regulator for private cannabis retail in Ontario, the AGCO has the authority to license, regulate, and enforce the sale of recreational cannabis. All the owners and operators of cannabis retail stores are subject to the Provincial Cannabis Licensing Act of 2018 and its regulations. So the last bit is Ontario Regulation 468/18. It establishes that until such time as more than 25 retail store authorizations may be issued, none may be issued to a cannabis retail store located in a municipality with a population of less than 50,000. So obviously we're a little ways away from either 50,000 or the 25 retail stores. So they have the province has allocated who the municipalities are above that 50,000 who are going to get the licenses, but beyond that, they haven't been established yet, to my knowledge. They're in the process, the licensing process, but they haven't actually been established. municipal considerations for retail cannabis use. Smoking and vaping is prohibited, you know that. In enclosed public places and workplaces, schools and child care centers, restaurants and bar patios, public outdoor spaces prescribed by the Smoke-Free Ontario Act, including playgrounds and sports fields, and any other areas set out in applicable municipal bylaws. Now that will come into play later when I'll speak to that in a little more detail, and it kind of ties into recreation. all modes of consumption are prohibited in workplaces, and vehicles and boats. So given the above and previous slides, council decided to opt out until further information was provided and public consultation was conducted. So my comments with respect to this then is the township may wish to consider enacting stricter smoking and vaping laws and signage to prohibit smoking and vaping on all township-owned properties, excluding rural allowance. So the current sign you see out front of this is basically 9 meters from any entrance, which is very difficult to enforce because nobody's out there with measuring tape. And people exiting and entering the property still have to go through those people in order to get to their vehicles. So it's not a particularly good system in my opinion. What they used to do with smoking and whatnot is you go out to the sidewalk. Essentially, what I'm suggesting the bylaw say for the township. The second one I hear is the township human resources will require a policy to address both medical and recreational cannabis use. So as an example, given that cannabis can remain in a person's system for more than 6 hours, a policy on recreational use by employees before reporting to work should be established, as well as consequences for reporting to work while still under the influence. Obviously, we just got a brand new garbage truck today. We want to make sure that it stays brand new, and if the operator decided to operate impaired, it may not stay that way. So we should have a policy to address that. Given the increased risks and costs, should the township allow or opt in retail stores? Staff are conducting a survey, as I had mentioned, to gather information from residences on this question, and this survey is available on the township website. Just to go back to my first comment there, that would imply that apply then to things like township-owned properties such as campgrounds, if we chose to. That's probably a contentious one that would potentially cause the most problems, is the campground in Dundalk itself, where people rent it, and therefore it's considered their own property for that period of time. However, we may have to look at some sort of either agreement or posting or specific bylaw where we say on any township property it's just not allowed. We don't want to see it there. That's a consideration for council to look at for sure. So that's all the staff comments I have at the moment. But if there are any additional comments or questions, staff are open to hear them.
Have any questions?
Do I have to come up?
Mm-hmm. I just say, just state your name.
Okay.
And we'll
set it for the record.
Oh. One more time.
Okay.
No.
Probably.
No, don't put it off.
Use your air.
Turn it off.
There
we go.
My name's Martin Gibson. The survey, to this date right now, how many people have answered?
So roughly, the survey has been open from February 28th, I believe, and we have almost 200 responses. So we're looking at, the last time I checked, we've got about 167 responses.
Thank you. I can talk very loud. Ed Fisher. Do I know what else? Okay.
Chief Building Fisher.
No. I just had a question in regards to enforcement. Currently, the tobacco legislation, especially the man meters, is being enforced by what we lovingly call the tobacco police. I believe it's a health order. All drug or alcohol-related offenses are enforced by the OPP. I'm wondering if that's continuing or whether it falls under somebody else's authority, legislated by somebody else or through somebody else.
Oops.
Oops.
Sorry. I did not mean that. Thank you for the comment. It's a very good question. Certainly, there's a bylaw enforcement officer. And council may choose to provide those duties to him, but at the same time, they may choose to do some of those with the current agencies that enforce them. So that will be one council's decision.
I'm not saying I hate people looking at my back. I'm worried somebody's going to put a knife in there. I don't trust you anymore. my next question, I said, you said council may change the enforcement. Do we have the legal authority to put that enforcement in place? Because it may fall under a different legislation.
Well, we'll certainly check into that. I know each municipality has their own ability to pass their own bylaws, particularly with regard to smoking.
Three Ontario Act, the public health officers will be responsible for obviously making sure that their enforcement is covered. However, if council wishes to add any additional delegated authority to a municipal bylaw enforcement officer, we would have to do that through the bylaw and include that in the duties of responsibility. That would then have to be approved by the Ministry of Attorney General's office, and if it gets approved or not, then you as a bylaw enforcement officer would take you or whoever it may be at the April 3rd meeting when you're going to be appointing people. So what we would do then is just make sure with the Ministry of Attorney General's office that you have the authority to do anything if there's any additional rules or regulations that we're going to put with our official plan. So we would have to get people for them to say what we're able to do on our property and what falls within our bylaws. I think generally it's through Smoke Free Ontario that they would have to make those enforcement calls.
And set fines.
And set fines.
Thank you.
Wonderful
information.
Any other comments? Ryan?
Oh, I guess we're done. Mr. Chair, I'm Brian Millman. It strikes me, your example about the campgrounds strikes me as a little odd as to why we restrict it there any more than we restrict alcohol. It is, as you correctly pointed out, their place of residence. So I don't think we really need any more levels of enforcement or authorities strolling through the park than we already have. I'm inclined to think that if people are acting in a mature way, and that's not always guaranteed, of course, but if they are doing that, then why do we need to enforce any more rules or create any more rules? And as far as the 9 meter thing, I'm not interested in sending residents out to the side of Grove of 9 to smoke a cigarette. If they want to smoke a cigarette, do it outside the 9 meters, but I'm sure I want to send them out on the side of Grey Road 9, have them run down by somebody coming to a council meeting late. Not that that ever happens, but.
That's sure.
So, anyways, there's my comment. I do trust my back to these guys.
You'll learn.
I have a question about rather than retail sales, how are they dealing with consumption? We're looking at just smoking, but you could also eat, drink, and whatever. Is there any impact, say, on a restaurant that wants to sell cannabis and use beer, or you know what I mean? It's looking at the difference between what an LCBO, that you just have retail sales, but you don't consume it there. How are they dealing with consumption of products?
That's a very good question. And as soon as we hear from the province and how they're going to do that, we'll be happy to relay that.
That's a very neat answer.
Because there's no regulations currently out for that. So the entire province is, we don't know yet, but we'll keep you posted. Well, if there's no more comments, again, I'll invite people to do the survey online, and to you could certainly put them in writing and give them to the clerk or myself, and then we'll move over to the next portion of the meeting, which is for recreation, I believe. Oh, sorry, the survey closes on Monday, just to let everyone know, so you have the weekend to get it done.
Good job, Jamie.
Mm-hmm. Yes, this is Jamie. He's the new legislative and communications coordinator.
Been here 2 days in a row. Well, almost.
He came back.
Yeah. Aren't we all?
Yeah.
The second portion of this open house, I guess, is recreation. What I have here is a presentation on what we're working on in the recreation department, just to communicate some of the ideas we're going forward with, some of the challenges we have, and some of the ideas in the parklands. And the slide presentation is put together. It is rolling currently in the arena on the TV for all the public to see. If anybody wants to see it again, but just to go through the slides, if there's any questions along the way, I'll take them as I go, I assume. Okay. So, the next slide, or what we're working on here, this is the information we're putting on the TV with regards to the auditorium renovation. This is the floor plan that we are presenting in the RFQ, and it's sort of where we will lead the architect and engineers to develop for the needs of the early on and needs of the community. Within that floor plan, what we will be working on is a youth drop-in center. This is a picture or a concept of what we are looking at in the youth drop-in center. Perhaps ping pong tables, some Xbox games for the kids to play. It's just an area that they will come in and have access to. We're currently treating it as a membership to gain in. That way we have a little bit more control over who comes in and who doesn't come in. If it's open to the public, then we kind of lose a little bit of our ability to say, no, you're not welcome. It's currently the after-school program has at least 30 youth registered in it now. They go on ice for sponge puck hockey, and they go upstairs and play some basketball and whatever sports we have going on upstairs. So we would like, one end will be dedicated to a youth drop-in center for that purpose. The middle section will be working and developing a gymnasium type area. We're hoping to have permanent basketball nets put in there, a permanent location that we can run our baseball practices that we're running now, pickleball, and other sports. Right now, there's a lot of time and effort put into transitioning from different sports the way it is right now. It's just like when the gymnasium is maybe done, that it's a lot easier if we can just go from one sport to the next. In the end, it's dedicated to the Ontario early years. This is their concept drawing that they give us. It'll be their dedicated space. I believe in the negotiations, we're currently looking at $400 a month in rent, and they would maintain that space. We, as a municipality, would not have access to that space. It would remain theirs. Their current plan is to use the space between the hours of 9 and 1 or 2. We would gain back the full use of the gymnasium and the youth drop-in center from 2 o'clock till closing. Some of the ideas we're throwing around on the wall when it's finished is a rock climbing wall. This will appeal to birthday parties and youth programming. Next slide, and like I said, this program, the slide presentation is rolling through the arena, so some of the slides are in just an order that's not really, it's not following quite an order, it's just whatever comes up, but some of the programs we're currently running and looking at near the youth, we have the ball hockey program, the indoor soccer starts here in 2 weeks, basketball program is running in August. We started a skate school in January. We had 15 new skaters to the community partaking in that program. The grade 7 to 12 after school program has been running since September. Adult programs, we have pickleball, the Women's Ball Hockey League still running Wednesday nights. Rec Basketball League ran right up till Christmas. And the rec ball hockey and the pickup hockey we're trying to expand into. The next slide is the actual advertisement for the indoor ball hockey and the soccer program that is starting next week. The next project on the recreation is looking at the Plateau Development Landscape Plan. some of the ideas that we're throwing into this park. This is a concept drawing of the spillways and paths. It may not look as fancy as that, or it could look exactly like that. But that's the ideas. We threw that slide to Flat Toe. He has a picture of that in our concept. In the park, there'll be walking trails looped all the way through it. This is a current picture of one of our walking trails we have now. There will be a playground, possibly a second playground in the Norman Jack Park once it gets developed, but we haven't received concept ideas from Flat Toe or what they're planning to do there. But the slides that we're rolling through are different ideas for park or for playground. I suggested to Flat Toe we do not want the traditional metal playgrounds. We have enough of them. We would prefer something more natural, more landscape design, such as this one here. It's just built into the existing landscape. Just something out of the normal that perhaps would draw the community into that park area. In the presentation, Flat Toe, there he had some bridges in his design. I just wanted to make sure that he saw the concept of the bridges that we would prefer. The rec department's not looking at wooden platform bridges in case of washer or anything. He says, we're going to put bridges in. We want good, solid, constructed bridges. One of the concept ideas we threw at him was a theater. This is a large-scale outdoor theater. The next slide is a small-scale outdoor theater. A toboggan hill was presented to him. When you're currently in the village of Dundalk, our toboggan hill runs in the Foodland parking lot. So perhaps we could look at some landscaping and some use of the topsoil to create a toboggan hill for the youth in Dundalk. And incorporated currently in the design of the Norman Jack Park is two mini soccer fields. We expect in the future that soccer will come back to our community with the development and the new homes coming in. Also, the next picture is just to show people that we are creating walking trails around the stormwater ponds. So when the trails are finished, you will walk more in naturalized areas, not on sidewalks and streets. And some of the other park land ideas that have come to the rec committee, dog parks been talked about in the community. Frisbee golf we've been throwing around in both our parks, Holstein and Memorial Park. And again, the toboggan hill, trying to find a safe area for the youth to toboggan. Holstein Park, we're always throwing around the idea of trying to utilize that park in the water. One of the suggestions we're having is trying to track down an outfitter that would maybe come up and once a month run canoe and kayak courses in that park. So we are working towards something along that lines. And for to update recreation, so this slide is running too. It just outlines that we have a master plan. It's on the website. It outlines everything in recreation from that master plan. We developed the community action plan, which identifies everything that we're thinking, where we're going, timeline for a lot of it. And we've now established a Southgate programming plan, which identifies all the past programming, all the current programming, and all the future programming we are looking at. The next section of slides is what's currently being worked on. We have the Old Town Hall issue. We have the task force working on the public side of it, and we're certainly working on the municipal side of it. The auditorium renovation, I discussed that earlier. Some of the challenges we're running at this point in time is the decreased usage in the arena. You can see from this slide that in 2005, they had over 1,300 paid hours. In 2017, we were decreased down to 893, so that's the equivalent of about $58,000 in decrease in revenue. Now with the increase of pricing and up, so the actual number there that we're probably down is about $30,000. Pool staffing is going to be an issue. We have four non-returning staff members this year. And last year when we had the applications out, we only had two applications for the positions. Just the bottom note there, Chesson and Paisley, I know they struggled over there. They actually ended up sharing staff. They closed the Chesley pool on Saturday and had the Paisley pool open on Sunday. The next week they switched. So if we do not get enough staff, we will probably be looking at reducing our public swim. And certainly weekends is the greatest issue. The radon gas issue has solved itself. The second go around of testing has proven that we only have one location that is reading high. A lot of that comes from the fact that the initial reports were not that clear to read. Myself and our previous office staff that was involved in that program both kind of misunderstood the concept of what the report was saying. And what it said was, if you're at this amount, you're over. But the very last line of the report, or buried in the report, it said the average over the time period is the determining factor. And when the average weight over time come back in, we were only close in one of our facilities, but not in the area that we have to fix them. So we are good on that. The recreation department's always looking at this issue. As new people move in, what's the expectation? Are we going to have the city expectation versus the rural expectation? Are we going to need a new facility to meet the needs? Are the people moving in going to accept rural Ontario and what recreation provides? The High Point Campground Electrical, it is in two issues. We had a tree fall down on the hydro pole and the hydro lines taking it to the back bush area. Under the new code, we can put only 5 sites back in the bush with the power we have. The other issue we have, we just had our electrical safety inspection done, and we found that all the previous site boxes will need to be replaced this year. Some of the wiring, the main feed wiring is bared right off, and the electrical safety commission basically said, no, you need to rewire that whole campground. So that's the presentation that's rolling through the arena. That's what we're working on in the rec department. So the community is seeing it and they are being aware of what we're trying to do.
Do we have any questions?
Kevin, for the presentation. I just have a couple of questions. I recall that there was a plan for beach volleyball.
Mm-hmm.
Harbor de Brain. My apologies. From Hopkins, Ontario.
From where?
I'm not in Grimoire. I'm outside of Dermore, but my postal address is Polking.
That's your 5 minutes.
Yeah, so I understood that we were working on beach volleyball and we were having trouble finding a location for that. Is that still a target?
With the beach volleyball, yes, it's still there. Our thought process before was that we'd try and put it in the new parkland coming forward, but in light of the campground issues and having to rewire, we are now, or staff is considering putting it in the very south end of the campground, as we cannot use the wiring there. So that location would be closer to the pool. And
where the community gardens are?
Just above it, yes.
The other one was, you were talking about bridges in the Plateau Parklands, and I recall there was an old bridge that we have on standby that we were hoping to incorporate that somewhere.
actually two of them are there, two of them will be incorporated. The plan originally is showing using one of the Heritage Bridge in the very south end of the walking trails. So that's kind of outside of the subdivision. The two stormwater ponds will go to the south, and I believe his plan originally is to use that as a link between basically the area of the subdivision. So they will be used, yes.
Is there, with regard to the decreased use of the arena and the decreased revenue, those hours, is that specifically to ice time, or is that decreased use overall?
That's specifically for ice time. So that's paid hours. Our public programming is still there. That's just, we, over the time, we've lost. Our senior men's team was 6 hours a week. We have no church groups running the ice anymore. Our week, we have 3 church groups and 4 family groups running. So we've lost considerable amounts of user groups.
Mm-hmm. And has any consideration been given to the Holstein Park as a for development or campground, or I love the idea of having a fitter come in to give kayaking, canoeing lesson opportunities, but what else could we be, what are we looking at for that park?
There's always ideas being thrown around. It has been discussed at the rec committee of a campground in there. Just the issue would be the cost of the infrastructure currently right now. We just don't really have the funds for a lot of new infrastructure and new development. DC charges are also sort of restricted on what you can use in recreation purposes. You can't buy land, you can't do certain things because it's on the responsibility of the developer. So a lot of the ideas and issues come basically on what funds will be available, capital grants. We're always looking at the grants to see what we can do. And it's also been thrown around to decrease some of the size of our parkland too, so that may come.
Thank you.
She used all my time.
You're welcome.
Glenn Walker, just mentioning that there, I've been working with Gray Highlands and the South Gray folks, and we've developed a new job board for Gray Highlands and Southgate. So there's other opportunities to market positions like at the pool. So if you send me, you know, like a Facebook ad or something, I place on there. And I'm also connected with Dufferin and Wellington job boards and the Great Bruce one. So maybe there's an opportunity to advertise in this wider area at really no cost.
It would be good because it's going to be an issue.
Brian Nolte from the eastern suburbs of Vermont. About the staffing issues for the pool, and I agree that's going to be an issue going forward for sure. I've been a long time advocate for a splash pad. I see Wellington North putting one in Mount Forest this year. Maybe is that something down the road that we need to look at, because there's of course no requirement for lifeguards at a splash pad, and higher usage rates for a broader spectrum of residents and so on.
Just with that, because some of the council would know, but approximately 7 years ago, we put forth a proposal for a splash pad at the Dundalk pool. At that point in time, we had recreation staff and council 100% behind putting the splash pad in. We had an advisory committee at the time that felt that a splash pad was not our highest priority need, and that we should allocate our funds to other issues. never really come back. I'm sure with the development and the expectations of what the Sea Folks moving in, it will be something that will probably prolong the life of the pool, and we will need something along that lines, or we will be looking at a new pool. The pool currently is 53 years old this year. It's been redone, the mechanical side of it. The pool structure itself is still strong as ever. There is accessible issues to that pool, and there's issues with perhaps the pool heights down the line. So the pool will be something we will be addressing one way or the other, probably within 10 years. So that was, to me, is what I had with incorporating the day. Thank you.
Do you have any other questions?